You have a short biography of Ben Hewitt in your packet. I'm not going to read it. I am going to talk a little bit about Greenfield, Massachusetts, and Hardwick, Vermont, however. Hardwick is about 1/6 the size of Greenfield, but it plays the same role that Greenfield plays as the economic center for a rural region. It has a restaurant that uses as many local ingredients as possible in its food and serves as a social center. Sound like People's Pint, Hope and Olive, Magpie? I think so. It has a food cooperative that has provided an anchor for the sale of many local food products, Greenfield's Market. It has agricultural land that's being developed into a community farm. Sure sounds like Just Roots to me. There are many other parallels, and there are also many differences. But both of us are dealing with some key questions. What is a local economy anyway? How do we make sure that healthy local food is accessible to everyone? How do we ensure that we have a healthy community? And how do we move forward in the face of challenges over which we have very little control? Ben is not going to give us the easy answers, but he will challenge us to come up with answers of our own that fit this region. It's my pleasure to welcome Ben Hewitt. Ben?
So my name is Ben Hewitt. I'm not from the government, and I'm here to help. So I'm going to start by just sort of telling you, I guess, a little bit of a story. And I can see already that I'm going to have some minor formatting issues, so there'll be spots in here where I'll have to pause and just sort of clarify some things. And the story is sort of based around this book I wrote a couple years ago, which I think conveniently enough is for sale, actually, in the back of the room, if you are so inspired. So the town of Hardwick, Vermont, is right on the southern edge of Vermont's Northeast Kingdom. So it's about 3 hours due north of here. And, you know, we thankfully did not get the snowfall that you guys got. So while I know it was hardship for you guys down here, we were sort of rubbing our hands with glee to think about all our southern New England neighbors buried under snow for once, and we were relatively dry. One of the reasons, and probably the primary reason I became so sort of compelled and engaged by this story, I guess to understand why, you would have to sort of know a little bit about the history of Hardwick. And so in the early 1900s, late 1800s, early 1900s, this is downtown Hardwick, by the way, pretty much the entirety of it. But in the early 1900s, Hardwick was actually a booming granite town. And the region, the largest granite company in the area, the Woodbury Granite Company, was actually the leading producer of building-grade granite in the world. And so there is Hardwick granite built into federal buildings all across this nation. And this, I love this photo. This is 20 teams of horses pulling a block of granite through downtown Hardwick. I love to think about the amount of labor that went into sort of procuring this granite. It's just amazing. I mean, this is almost near the end of the chain. Think about actually getting this out of the ground, getting it down off the mountain, down into town to this point here, where it then had to go to the shed to be processed and then shipped to wherever it was going to be installed. So during this period, the town was basically rocking and rolling. Like so many of our sort of small communities, there was an industry. This industry was largely fed with immigrant labor. It was rumored that during this period, Hardwick had more bars per capita than any town in North America, which was, I actually tried to verify that, but I sort of ran into a dead end there. But it gives you a sense, whether it's true or not, it gives you a sense of what was going on in this town. These guys, it was pretty much all men working in the quarries. Were making union wages. They were making good money, working 6 long days a week, and of course on Saturday night. What would you do if you just worked 6 weeks in the granite quarry, risking life and limb? I know what I'd do. I'd go to one of those bars, right? So the town earned this moniker, Little Chicago, and it was this sort of rocking and rolling place. Unfortunately for the granite industry, in the 1920s something came along, and it was called reinforced concrete. And so the granite industry died a very, very quick death in Hardwick, particularly the building-grade granite industry. And then, of course, came the Great Depression, and the town sort of entered this period of economic stagnation. For a long time, the unemployment rate in Hardwick has been about 40% higher than the Vermont state average, and the median income about 25% lower. A lot of people describe it as a depressed community, and I would never do that myself, because I believe that, you know, those kind of metrics don't really do enough to describe what a community really is. And while I would call it economically challenged, absolutely, I know from living in the area, I live about 8 miles to the east, I know what a vibrant community it has been for a very long time, even in the face of these economic challenges. But no question, it's an economically challenged community. So you can, I guess, sort of imagine my surprise when in, you know, about 5 or 6 years ago, I started to notice all these small-scale ag-based ventures popping up in Hardwick. My wife and I operate a small farm, diversified farm. I've sort of been engaged in small-scale agriculture. But I was a little surprised because I would not necessarily have expected that in a town like Hardwick. A lot of these ventures, I call them sort of agripreneurial ventures. They were very entrepreneurially minded. They were producing some really sort of high-end food products. And then I started to hear a lot of conversation about sort of, you know, implementing and blueprinting a regional food system, a local food system. And this to me was, you know, I was all ears because while I sort of, you know, had this, in my head, had this understanding that yes, we need to move toward regional food systems for so many of the reasons that have already been outlined today, I didn't really know what that looked like. What do you mean? What does that really look like? And I thought this would really provide an interesting case study. So early on, sort of recognizing that I didn't really know what I was looking for, I did a lot of sort of, you know, heavy thinking, or as heavy as I can get. And I came up with the four commandments of local food, according to me. You can see my disclaimer up there, right? And that's just to keep me out of hot water in case anyone disagrees with me. But you know, commandment number one, it shall feed the locals, right? If you're going to make and create a local food system, shouldn't it be feeding the people in that community? Anyone disagree with that? Right, okay. Everyone's sort of half nodding their heads. Is it just too early for these heavy questions here or what? Come on. Yes, it should feed the locals, all right? Okay, thank you. All right. Commandment number two, it should be circular. But basically the idea that it is going to operate in some sort of relatively closed-loop system. Now, let's be clear, we're a long way from creating perfectly circular food systems in all of our communities. But I think what I talk about is sort of bending the ends, you know, at least sort of working toward that circle. Maybe it's sort of like a, you know, a parenthesis on its side, I don't know. Maybe it's some kind of, I don't know the names of all those funky shapes, but maybe it's a triangle, I'm not really sure. But clearly we need to move away from where we are right now. We'll talk a little bit more about these shapes in a second. It shall be based on sunshine. The idea that it's not going to be reliant, or at least overly reliant, on non-renewable inputs. I mean, realistically, yes, we're still going to need non-renewable inputs for some period of time. But the idea, ultimately, is that we're moving toward a system that's based on sunshine. And number four, it's going to offer viability to producers. Right. I see someone laughing already. Right. Which brings me to my next point. There's a problem here. There's a real problem. And it's the fact that number one and number four so often are diametrically opposed to one another. You know, it's particularly in a community like Hardwick where you have a really limited median income, you have folks of very limited means, and you have producers who are now trying to produce products in accordance with and with an honest accounting of their practices, right? Which basically means that they are going to, in order to have viability, they're going to have to produce products that are going to cost more than that which we get out of the commodity agriculture system, right? America spend on average about 9.5% of their income on food, the lowest of any industrialized nation. Of course, that doesn't account for all the externalized costs, which we could talk about all day, but that's the reality, is that when most people go into their supermarket and compare those prices to what they might pay at a local health food store or a co-op that's offering local food, they're just looking at that 9.5%, right? So I told you I'd talk a little bit about the shape of food systems. This is what I call a straight line food system. The truck is really just, you know, sort of emblematic. Both of my sort of adolescent fascination with large trucks, but also with the waste that is really part and parcel of the industrial, or I call it sort of the dominant food system. You know, we have coming in one end, you have all of these non-renewable inputs. You know, okay, seed is for the time being renewable, but not if some of the larger agricultural corporations had their way, they would actually be non-renewable. And out the other end, after it travels its 1,500 miles, which is, you know, about the average journey of the average piece of food in this country, we throw away 40% of the food that's produced in this nation, right? So if anyone thinks that hunger in the U.S. And in North America as a whole is an issue of production, you can just tell them about throwing away 40% of our food. It's an issue of priorities. It's an issue of the way we've structured our system so that we can't really seem to get that food to the people who really need it. But this is a straight line food system. I'm really struck, and I was glad to hear some of the other presenters talk a little bit about, or not a little bit, a lot, the issue of money kept coming up. Because there's another system in this country that looks just like this one, and it's the industrial money system, right? And I used to really think, like, well, we got to develop local food system as an antidote to the industrial food system. But you know what? It's not the industrial food system that's the problem here. It's the industrial money system. And we'll talk a little bit more about what we can do with regional food systems to sort of wean ourselves off the industrial money system. So this is a circular food system, a food web. Call it what you will, but basically the idea is that you have some sort of, you know, regionalized circle that you're drawing that is interconnected with your various facets of the system, and you could continue. This is really just an example. You could add innumerable components to this and draw arrows all over this, but the idea basically is that you're making these connections within a community for the betterment, you know, of everyone along the circumference of the circle. Here's the question. Right? This is probably why a lot of you are here today to sort of talk about, like, how do we really sort of implement some of these strategies, not just, you know, that I'm talking about, but that other people are talking about today. Well, I sure do believe child labor could play a part. Because you have no idea, if you withhold food for 2 or 3 days, how hard a couple of young boys will dig for potatoes. I say this in jest, you know, absolutely, but I think it's also clear that, you know, we have a lot of leverage with children, and I'm not talking about just in terms of labor, I'm talking about getting them engaged with food, and getting them to really sort of, you know, care about where their food comes from, and even to develop a taste, you know, for food that is just sort of simple, and I don't want to use the word pure, but hasn't been processed to death. I mean, I think one of the real problems we have, you know, when we try to sort of get people engaged with local food, forget about the cost issue, forget about the fact that they, you know, they feel like they don't have time to cook, but there's the fact that they've spent, you know, however much of their life, probably the majority of their life, eating foods that are so heavily processed and loaded down with chemicals and sweeteners and salts that they just don't like it, you know? And so as every drug dealer knows, if you want to get a kid addicted, you get them early, you get them young. Right? So I think we need to take a page right out of that playbook. And I was really excited to hear about some farm-to-school initiatives in this area, which I think is really, really important. I want to talk a little bit about diversity. Up here, you see the Buffalo Mountain Food Co-op on your upper... I have to do this, too. Yeah, on your upper left. I guess my view here is exactly the same as your... Oh, wow, that's great recognition there. But, yeah, diversity is so key. I'll tell you a little anecdote about the Buffalo Mountain Food Co-op. It's been in operation since about 1975. It's one of the longest sort of continually running cooperatives in the U.S. And during the first few years of its business, it was located in the same building as a gun shop and a liquor store. So you could... You know, in Vermont, we call that one-stop shopping, right? You get your tofu, your 357, and your Jim Beam, and you only have to go in one door. Super convenient. So, you know, diversity is really key because obviously if you're trying to create a regional food system that's going to feed the locals, you don't want, you know, I mean, cheese is great and everything, right? But you don't want to just eat cheese 24/7, 365 days a year. You're going to want a variety of food products. That makes total sense. Couple of less obvious reasons that I think diversity is really, really important. One is that every product or everything you grow requires different inputs. So if you don't have that diversity, if you try to sort of specialize in some kind of agricultural niche, you quickly overwhelm the region's capacity to provide the inputs, right? And you end up back in that place where you're having to import all sorts of stuff to actually provide the inputs to create this product. And there's another issue that is actually, I think, even a little bit less obvious, but perhaps is the most important, which is that when you have diversity, you reduce the sense of competition among producers, and you create, I think, an environment of collaboration rather than competition. And I think this is going to be really key going forward as communities try to sort of implement regional food systems, is to not have producers sort of operating in their own little vacuums, but to create this collaborative environment and this sense of community around this, you know, sort of industry, so that people, you know, not only have the emotional support, but in some cases have financial support. In this area, excuse me, there's a business owners group that gets together, and they have informally loaned each other over $500,000 over the past few years. And that's something that I think that can really sort of evolve out of this sense of collaboration. It's something I think that can evolve out of this sort of New England heritage of interdependence and community and, you know, communal trust for one another. And I think it's a real advantage that we may have as we move forward with these. You know, regional fertility, composting is, you know, a lot of people say, well, what are the sort of hard assets here that you can actually blueprint and you know, recreate in each community? And, you know, I've come to believe that there is no blueprint, because there's no blueprint for a community. Every community is different. They have different ecosystems, they have different cultural climates, they have different intellectual property, they have different physical resources. There's no such thing as a regional food system or a healthy food system. There are, you know, there are endless variants on that, on what that can look like, because there are endlessly variable communities. But one thing that I think is absolutely replicable is composting. Right, I think every community, just like it has a police station and a fire department, should have a composting facility. Because if we're not going to get that 40% of food waste to the people that can actually consume it, which is, you know, we're not. We should be trying, but it's probably not going to happen. We could at least be turning it into soil fertility, right? Ingenuity is going to be really keen here, because we've got to figure out ways to sort of think our way outside the box, you know? This is a photo of, anyone here heard of the Jasper Hill cellars up outside of Hardwick? They're in Greensboro, actually. So Jasper Hill's got, it's actually two businesses. There's Jasper Hill Cheese, and then there's the cellars at Jasper Hill. And the idea behind the cellars is a facility. You can see, this is Matteo Keeler standing in front of one of their aging rooms. They have the capacity to age 2 million pounds of cheese a year. Now, they're only milking 50 cows. And those 50 cows ain't making 2 million pounds of cheese a year. And this is a very sort of European model. The idea is that you can create a facility, a centralized facility, that can actually bring in cheese from other small-scale cheesemakers. Because as it turns out, if you want to make cheese, the majority of the investment and some of the knowledge, a lot of the knowledge, is in the aging process. And so it's actually not all that difficult to make the cheese. It's very difficult to age it properly, and also to have the savvy to know how to sort of market it and get it out on the market. And so they're trying to sort of take that, you know, reduce that barrier. As we all know, in this region, small-scale dairy farming is in perpetual crisis mode, right? Vermont, in, I don't know what the numbers are like in Mass, but in Vermont, in the 40s, we had 11,000, over 11,000 dairy farms. We now have less than 1,000. Right? And the Department of Ag, Agency of Ag, will tell you, oh, but we're milking the same amount of cows, it doesn't matter. Yeah, right. It matters. It matters, because it's absolutely a toll in our communities. To move all of those cows onto ever larger farms is a huge toll in our communities, and it's a huge toll on agriculture, I think, in our state, because it simply does not expose the same number of people to agriculture. So, I'm sure I don't have to explain what this is, so we'll just skip right by that. No, that's a joke. This is, for those of you who don't know and don't have one in your garage, a squash seed extractor, owned and designed by High Mowing, which is one of the businesses in the Hardwick area. The best part of this was, right before this, these two workers were going through the field, and they had broad axes, literally, and they were like hacking apart pumpkins and squash, like right in the field. It was incredibly gruesome and violent in a very sustainable way. This is a photo of Claire's. Susan mentioned Claire's. Claire's opened about 3 years ago in Hardwick with a real strong commitment to purchasing from local producers. Their first year of business, they did an audit, and they sourced 78% of their ingredients from within 15 miles, right? So that's pretty impressive, I think. You know, I'd also recommend taking your own ketchup if you go, because I'm not really fond of their local ketchup. But, you know, it's a great place. They've gone to great lengths to try to create affordable options for people in the community. I'm sure some people still feel like it's out of their reach, but the reality is that they are trying to operate in that sort of honest economy where they're trying to pay producers a fair price for their products. Here's a formatting issue, but this is the Food Venture Center. And the Food Venture Center, which is now finished, I really need to update this slide, and my apologies, but it's a shared use commercial kitchen and food business incubator. And you know, one of the main barriers to this type of industry and to creating small scale food ventures is a regulatory environment that is tilted very, very heavily in favor of commodity agriculture and large-scale processors. And it's usually around the issue of food safety, and it's often it's based on really flawed assumptions, I believe, regarding what's safe and what's not. But that, all that said, the reality is if a small producer wants to bring a product to the retail market, they're really faced with a conundrum. It's like they either got to get really leveraged and go into a lot of debt to install a commercial kitchen, which puts them in a place now where they've got to mark up their product now beyond the means of their friends and neighbors often. And the Food Venture Center, one of their main goals is to sort of reduce that barrier by allowing people to rent the facility by the hour. So they have a fully certified commercial kitchen. They have a commercial chef on hand to help people actually develop recipes. You can actually ship right out of here if you're actually shipping your product. Why isn't this happening everywhere, right? My argument basically is that this makes total sense. We've got to wean ourselves off the dominant food system. We've got to wean ourselves off the dominant industrial money system. But why isn't this going on everywhere? And this is a question I think a lot of people are asking themselves in this day and age. So I thought I would just talk about some of the expectations, policy, and big fat lies that are sort of standing in our way, I think. Number one, is this idea that food should be cheap. And I used to spend a lot of time sort of talking about, how are we gonna make this food affordable for people? We gotta somehow make this food affordable. And I don't wanna suggest that there aren't very real reasons why people can't feel like they can't afford this food. And I don't wanna suggest that we shouldn't try to get this food to people who are economically challenged. But I think the larger shift, and the shift that really needs to happen, is that as a culture, we need to recognize that food should not be cheap, right? This is like the most intimate form of commerce that you're engaging in on a day-to-day basis. This is what you're putting into your body to sustain you, and you expect it to be cheap, right? I just don't buy it anymore. So I'd love to talk more about that later on, but it's a complicated issue. I, as a producer of food myself, knowing what this stuff costs, I'm sort of tired of apologizing for having to charge what it actually cost me to produce it, right? So I don't have time to cook. I got this little snarky parenthetical up here, right? Again, there are very real reasons that people don't have time to cook. We have single parents working two jobs to put any kind of food on the table, much less actual truly nutritious food. So again, that's true. But I can't help but sort of notice that in 2010, Americans set a record for television watching at 34 hours a week, right? So on average, Americans are watching basically a work week's worth of television every week. Now, someone who doesn't even own a TV, I just don't even know where those hours come from. I can't even imagine watching 3 hours of TV a week, frankly. But, 34, it's absolutely stunning to me. And actually, I just saw a thing, the children today, high school-aged kids today, now between TV and digital devices spend 53 hours a week in front of some kind of screen. So, the tomato fallacy, I'm sure I don't have to talk about that. We'll just move right. Oh, you don't know about the tomato fallacy. So the tomato fallacy comes out of an experience I had about 4 or 5 years ago when my family and I took what I sort of describe as a white trash vacation, which means we bought an old Dodge van off Craigslist for $1,000, and we built a bed in the back of it, and we strapped all our belongings to the roof, and we went south. Kept waiting for it to get warm. It was like the coldest winter in Florida ever on record, and it never got warm. We were in the Everglades, and we woke up one morning, it was 32 degrees. There were like fish dying and, alligators going into hibernation or whatever they do. But on the way down, we're driving down, I think it's 95 north-south, right? Okay, so we're driving down the Dodge, got it maxed out at about 62 miles an hour, and see this tractor-trailer truck coming up the northbound lane, and it's got these open mesh sides, and it's full of green balls. And I said to my wife, her name's Penny, I said, oh my gosh, there must be a tennis ball factory down here. And she said, you idiot, those are tomatoes. And so the tomato fallacy is the idea that one tomato is equivalent to the other, and that the only way we should really be judging those tomatoes, this gets back to the issue of cost of food, but the only really, sort of metric that we, to judge those, is price. We don't really think about the fact that they actually might be different nutritionally, quality, taste-wise, whatever. It's this fallacy that one piece of food is equal to the other, and that the only real, sort of meaningful way to assess it is based on its price. That's the tomato fallacy. And I'm struck, you know, I live in a rural blue-collar community, and this gets back again to the issue of price. You know, I've got a lot of friends and neighbors who I think would complain about the price of local food, would say it's too expensive. And yet, I know very well how willing they are to debate the relative merits of a Ford versus a Chevy diesel motor, right? I mean, it's Chevy, clearly, but the point I'm trying to make is that, you know, we are at a place in our culture where we're willing, perfectly willing to spend hours, you know, sort of wondering, should we buy that flat screen TV or that flat screen TV? Or, oh my gosh, the iPhone 4S is out. I better get out and get in line, right? And get that. But we're really not in a place where we're valuing the thing that's actually going to, you know, that actually sustains us. That's the reality. Regulations and subsidies, I mean, we could do a whole day on this. Zoning is a big issue. It's not a big issue where we are. But as you come into communities, more urbanized communities, it's a huge issue. I mean, we have a culture now that has almost entirely severed itself from agriculture and you know, doesn't really want to live in the midst of the food production that is actually allowing us to sort of carry on day in, day out. And I think there's actually could argue that there's very good reasons for that. And I would say that. In a sense, that may be true because we've arrived at this place with agriculture where it is, frankly, disgusting. You know, the way we do most of our agriculture in this country, I wouldn't want to live next to it either. But that's not what I'm talking about here. And, you know, again, it comes down to the money issue, I think, just, you know, time and time again. I want to make perfectly clear that this is a formatting issue and I'm not talking about e-agriculture, right? I'm very much talking about an analog process of growing food in the soil. But I like to sort of tweak the idea of sustainable ag. I've got no problem with sustainability per se, and I think it's a concept that most people grasp. It's the one that most people are familiar with. But I also don't think it's enough, and I also think that we can actually do better. And so I want to talk a little bit about agriculture, and I think the capacity it has to actually be restorative, not just sustainable, but restorative. I'm going to leave this one up for a while, and I just sort of like to reflect on it myself a little bit. So, you know, we've got a health crisis in this country, right? Is anyone going to argue with me in regards to that? According to the Harvard School of Public Health, 1,051,000 diet-related deaths annually, right? Okay, and there's been an enormous increase in that since only about 30 years ago. We've tripled the rate of obesity in our school-aged children since 1970, tripled, right? Can you imagine if we lost 1 million Americans annually to terrorist attacks? Can you imagine what the response would be, right? Can you imagine if we lost 1 million Americans annually to acute foodborne illness? Right now, we're at about 3,000 people a year dying of acute foodborne illness. And look at the response there. You actually see that in the headlines. You actually see policy around that. You don't see any policy around the fact that we're losing over 1 million Americans annually to long-term foodborne illness, is what I would call it. You know, most often out of diabetes, obesity, and other sort of diet-related conditions. You know, the conversation around soil in this country is not just lacking, it's basically non-existent. And if you want to talk about a natural resource that we should be protecting, you know, we should be really talking about soil an awful lot. I mean, we were really lucky in this country to have been basically endowed with some of the best farmland in the world, and all we've done is abused that over the last, you know, mostly 50 years, but really over about the last 100 years. And so we're now losing, excuse me, out of the bed basket of our country, we're losing topsoil at a rate that's 30 times natural replenishment. And this is a kind of a crisis situation that gets absolutely no attention. So, you know, small-scale agriculture that's done in a manner that's respectful of the environment, you can actually build topsoil with agriculture, right? People don't understand this because they think of agriculture as being this sort of commodity crops or confinement animal operations, but you can actually use livestock to build topsoil. You know, we need desperately to be moving in this direction. I apologize a little bit for the formatting. Macs and PCs are supposed to play nice, but they don't always. I'm gonna talk a little bit more about the money issue because I think the money issue is probably where we have the best leverage here. And I think one of the problems with talking about this stuff is that we tend to over and over preach to the choir, right? It's why I do not like to talk. I have absolutely struck words like artisanal from my vocabulary I would like to take that word out back and shoot it in the head, right? I hate the word artisanal. No offense to any artisanal producers here, or artisans, okay? But the problem is that the words like artisanal, even sometimes organic or local, are carrying with them a certain stigma, right? That some people just don't really want to get engaged with. So let's talk about money. Because who does not see the value of keeping money in a community? Doesn't matter if you're progressive, libertarian, Republican, Democratic, doesn't matter. You can see and understand the value of keeping money in your community, right? Weaning ourselves off this industrial money system that's basically hollowing out all of our communities. And so there have been numerous studies done on this, and so that's why I have a range here. So I don't want to make it seem like I'm cherry picking. So I've taken the range. All right, when you go and buy an anonymous food-like substance from anywhere, at your local supermarket, anywhere from 15 to 20 cents of every dollar you spend is going to stay in your community, okay? If you go to your farmer's market, if you go to a local co-op, you buy basically direct from producer or from someone who's actually purchasing that from a producer in the region, 50 to 65 cents out of that dollar is going to stay in your community, right? And it, you know, this doesn't just apply to food. Don't get me wrong. I'm here mostly because I'm to talk about food, but let's be clear that there are other products that it's worth thinking about where they come from. So I just wanted to apply this toward Massachusetts just to sort of give you a sense, I think, of what the potential is. Right now, per capita, you're spending about $6.38 annually on direct-to-producer sales in Mass. All right, now I don't want to do any bragging, but in Vermont, we're up to 36. Okay? And Mass is the third richest state in the nation, right? So y'all got the money, don't you? You can do it. So this gives you a total revenue of about $42 million direct-to-producer consumer sales. So your per capita personal income, $51,005. Whoa. Damn, I'm going to move down here. Which means that if you're spending the average 9.5% of your income on food, you're at about $4,900 annually per person on food. With me so far? If anyone sees a mistake, math was never my thing. So if anyone sees a mistake, please point it out. So I'm just sort of wondering what would happen if you allocated 5% of that $4,900 to spend at direct to producer, what that might do. And all of a sudden, you go from, where were we? We were at $42 million a year in sales, right? And this is, you know, statewide, but, you know, it obviously can be, it works at any scale. You could bring this down to the community level. I just don't have the numbers for Greenfield. So now, all of a sudden, we go from $42 million to $1,600,000,000, $1.6 billion in sales, just if we allocate 5% of our annual food budget. Now, remember that other figure I talked about is that of this $1.6 billion, 50 to 65% is actually going to stay in your communities, as opposed to 15 to 20%, right? So the impact is much, much higher. Okay, let's go to 10%. $3.2 billion, right? Okay, right? You can call me a dreamer, but I know I'm not the only one. Let's talk about 25%. All of a sudden, we're up to $8 billion a year in Mass alone. What does this mean for jobs, potentially? This is direct from the Massachusetts Department of Tourism. For every $115,000 spent by tourists in Mass, one job is created. Is that perfectly analogous to agriculture? I don't know. But I think it's fair enough to use that number as to look at what the potential might be. So if we look at doing 5%, we're looking at 14,000 jobs. If we look at doing 10%, we're looking at 28,000 jobs. And if we look at 25%, we're looking at 70,000 jobs in the state, right? So, you know, let's shoot for the 5%. It seems attainable to me. It really seems attainable to me. Is anyone going to argue with bringing 14,000 jobs to Massachusetts right now in this environment? Anyone? Yeah, that's what I thought. Let's talk a little bit about community, because this, you know, this is directly connected to this. The fact that on average Americans move every 5.2 years. Why are they moving? Because they don't have work. Because they're having to move for work. They're having to move because their boss is telling them they have to move. You know, maybe some people really do want to move every 5 years. That's fine. I'm not saying they shouldn't have that right. But the reality is, you know, how do you build like this strong communities and vibrant communities if people are having to move in and out of them every 5 years? Well, the answer is I think you don't. Or at least it's much, much harder. It's going to take much, much longer. And you need to give people a reason to stick around and have a stake in their community to make this stuff work. You know, anecdotally, I thought I would just give you a sense of what is going on in our region. You know, over the past 5 or 6 years, created about 100 jobs in, you know, the broader region. Hardwick's only 3,200. The broader region's about 8,000, in a community of about 8,000 people. Most of these businesses have been hiring right through, you know, the worst economic downturn since the Great Depression. And this last one is the one, you know, we kind of have a good problem, I guess, right now, which is that we have so many young people either coming to the region or choosing to stay in the region and pursue ag-based ventures, that all of a sudden we find ourselves with a little bit of a shortage of farmland, or, you know, we don't have really enough to go around. It's not that prices have really risen out of reach. It's more that the land just isn't really there, which sounds like a problem, and maybe it is, but it also, I think, points to the fact that we have something really cool going on, which is that people want to be there. Young people want to be there. They do not see this community as a dead end anymore. They do not see that it might be better for them to move down to Boston, right? So the issue of replicability, I mean, I talked a little bit earlier about blueprinting, and, you know, how that's really, I think, a fallacy, and I really believe that. I mean, I think we were talking about adapting, not adopting. You know, we were talking about identifying your resources, assessing your resources, identifying your log jams. For instance, with the log jams, everywhere I go, one of the primary things that comes up is, we have people who want to buy locally raised, pasture-raised meats, and there's no place to slaughter them, right? I have not yet been to a community, and I've been to quite a few, where people have said, we don't have a problem with meat production, frankly. So there's a logjam that comes up almost everywhere. You know, so how can we make that happen for people? This is not for me to tell you how to do that. This is for, you know, people in your planning commission and in your town to think about. You know, how can we make this an opportunity for somebody? And resource sharing, I talked a lot about collaboration. I mean, I think that's really, really key, which is bringing people together to collaborate across this sector. And actually across all the sectors, these are all interconnected. You know, the issue of energy. Agriculture as a sector is the largest user of energy in this country. So when we talk about energy and climate change and the need to wean ourselves off foreign oil, I mean, it's you know, I think all these initiatives y'all are doing with energy efficiency are absolutely critical. But realize that agriculture needs to be part of that conversation. And it actually, I think, deservedly should be, you know, right up there with all of these other initiatives. You know, I'm really struck, I guess, by the fact that we sort of look at this as something sort of new and different and progressive, when the reality is, I believe that we have been living through the aberration, right? What I'm talking about, you know, we forget, 100 years ago, every community in this country was an agricultural community because they needed to be. And so we're talking about returning to something that has a lot more sort of historical basis and depth to it than what we have all sort of grown up in. So this is not the aberration. And I think ultimately, you know, we need to stop asking ourselves sort of, you know, what is the cost of sort of moving in this direction? What are the challenges that we face? And really, you know, maybe the question we should be asking ourselves is, you know, what is the cost of maintaining the status quo? And with that, I would like to thank you very much for your time and attention. So.